Are you confused by the arguments over absolute and relative risk reduction statistics as they pertain to the use of statins? Well, if you're not confused, maybe you should be, because the numbers being given to us by both sides don't tell the whole story. In this video, we're going to take a look at an ad that really illustrates the disconnect between the two sides, and then we're going to run a thought experiment and just see if that can shed some more light on the subject. Stay tuned. So we're going to take a look at this controversy by examining an ad that you could probably find in your standard Newsweek or Time magazine several years ago. I don't know exactly which magazines they were in, but it's one that advertises Lipitor, which is the best-selling drug of all time, never mind statin of all time. And in this ad, they make this claim. Lipitor reduces the risk of heart attack by 36%, asterisk. You always have to know if there's an asterisk there. There's some other part of the story. And in the fine print, when we follow that asterisk, we get this. That means in a large clinical study, 3% of patients taking a sugar pill or placebo had a heart attack compared to, now I say here 1.9%, they say 2%, it's actually 1.9%, which is better for them. But it's 1.9% of patients taking Lipitor. They rounded for the ad, you know, no foul there. And the absolute risk reduction people take a look at that and they say, well, wait a minute. If you reduced it from 3% down to 1.9%, that's only a 1.1% reduction. But the pharmaceutical people say, yeah, but 1.1% is 36% of 3%. So you see how the mathematical manipulation they do there. That's called the relative risk reduction, or as I like to call it, the marketing risk reduction. And the 1.1% figure is the absolute risk reduction. So that is the crux of the argument between the two sides. So here's another way of looking at it. It's semantically different. Mathematically, it's actually the same. The relative risk reduction, which we're going to call RRR from here on in, only considers the people who would have had a heart attack if they were left untreated. And then they were treated, and we see how much of a reduction they had. So if we were to draw this as a pie chart, where the circle represents everybody who was going to have a heart attack, and the green area is the area represents the people who didn't have a heart attack because they were treated and they were saved from a heart attack. And the red area is the people who had a heart attack anyway. Well, right away we see, well, the red part, that seems too big to me. I would like the green part to be much bigger, but it is what it is, and it's at least better than nothing. That's the relative risk reduction, the RRR. The absolute risk reduction, the ARR, it considers everyone in the study. So we have to introduce a new color. We're going to draw a pie chart again. And the yellow represents everybody in the study who wasn't going to have a heart attack anyway. And then the red and the green still mean the same. People who did have a heart attack, and the green is the people who would have had a heart attack but didn't have a heart attack. And you'll see that it reduces, the green area is what we're really interested in, reduces down to that little sliver of the whole population. And that's that 1.1%. That's the ARR of 1.1%. So that's just another way of looking at that. And we're going to use these pie charts throughout the thought experiment that's coming up. So we're going to perform a thought experiment, and we're going to grant assumptions to the pharmaceutical company as generously as we can, just to see how strong we can make their argument. This is a rhetorical device. We're not going to worry about how the statins work. We're not going to get into any of that stuff. That's topics for another video. So our first assumption is that the relative risk reduction is consistent across all risk levels. So that means that the higher your risk, the greater absolute benefit you'll get by applying the relative risk to it. So if your risk is 80% of having a heart attack, you're going to get a much higher benefit in terms of total reduction than if you only have a 3% risk of a heart attack. So that's the first assumption. Now we know that's really too generous, because if we had a crystal ball and we had a pool of 100 people and our crystal ball said they're all going to have a heart attack tomorrow, well, that's a very high probability of a heart attack, by the way. If we were to start them on statins tonight, we know we wouldn't save any of them. They're going to have their heart attacks. You know, that's kind of intuitive to us. But when we talk about these risk reduction values, we really should be applying a reasonable time frame to them, because they don't stand alone. if you say your probability of a heart attack is 3%, but you don't say over what time period, it doesn't mean anything really. And I'll get back to that. Your risk of a heart attack, which we'll call the PR of HA, is known with reasonable precision. We're just going to grant that for now, and I'll get to how we're going to calculate it. And again, you can get a serious case of the whatabouts in this video if we try chasing down too many holes. So just remember what we're doing here. We're just granting the pharmaceutical company the best that we can just to see how the maximum goodness of their argument. So you could calculate your personal ARR by simply multiplying the relative risk reduction, which is 36%, where we, by assumption one, everybody gets 36% relative risk reduction. So your ARR would be that 36% times the probability of a heart attack. So I just picked this number, just as a, for instance, if your probability of a heart attack was 22%, and when we're dealing with mathematically dealing with probabilities, you always sign between 0 and 1, where a 0.22 means 22%. A probability of 1 means it's going to happen, a probability of 0 means it's not going to happen, and then everything in between. So if we were to multiply that 36% at 0.36 times the 0.22, the 22%, it'd come out your probability of getting any benefit from taking this treatment is 8%. So the key point here is that for your ARR to be as little as the 1.1% that gets trotted out by the people who are saying, oh, the absolute risk reduction is almost nothing. Well, that's true if your risk is almost nothing, but your risk would have to be 3%, that of the study group. And by the way, the ad didn't say how long the study went on. It went on for 3.3 years. So we usually normalize risk factors to a 10-year period. So in reality, these people had a 3% chance of having a heart attack over 3.3 years. Over 10 years, it would be approximately somewhere around 9 or 10%. And the absolute risk reduction presumably would actually have been greater than 1.1%. It would have been like 3.6%. So we're going to add that time element to the thought experiment. So we're going to grant the same first assumption that the relative risk reduction is consistent across all levels. And I'm making a little modification to the second one. I'm not going to say the editorial you. I'm going to say my risk of a heart attack is known with reasonable precision, because I'm going to use an online risk calculator to calculate what my risk of a heart attack was. And I'm going back in time on this. This is going to be really great here. So my third assumption is that my risk factors remain the same over time except for my age itself. So in other words, I'm going to go to this calculator. I'm going to put in all the values it's asking for and what it considers as part of a risk factor. That's another what about we can chase down some other time. I'll get to that in another video. But all I'm going to do is I'm going to put in the values that I had, because I have records of them, when I was age 50, and I'm going to look ahead and say for the next 30 years, what was my risk? Okay, so I used a well-known cardiovascular risk calculator that I found online. There's actually several of them. I'm not even going to mention which one it is because it's not really pertinent to our thought experiment. But the calculator asked me a bunch of questions on my health, the standard factors, and we can argue about whether those factors really are meaningful or if the calculator's interpreting them correctly, topic of another video. So let's just take it for the moment as valid. So I went back in time and I put in my values at age 50, my family history, that sort of thing. And it told me I had a 5.9% chance of a heart attack in the next 10 years. Oddly specific, 5.9%, not 6%. Again, that's a what about we can chase another time. So then I went ahead 10 years and I took those same numbers that I had, all the same health statistics I had at age 60, except for I'm 60 years old now. And I put them in, and it told me I had 11.8% chance of a heart attack over the next 10 years. So in other words, it doubled the chances just by my aging. Just the fact that I got 10 years older means I've doubled my chance of having a heart attack over the next 10 years. And then I advanced it up to age 70, which I haven't reached yet, but I put in those same values, and it told me by that time I have like a 20.7% chance of having a heart attack between age 70 and 80. Now that's not quite double, but it's still an absolute change of about 9%. So it's basically saying this is the effect aging has on our probability of a heart attack. So what I want to do is I want to calculate my 30-year risk, because when you're told you're going to be put on a statin, they're saying you're on this for life. I said, okay, well, fine. I'm age 50. That was when I was first put on statins. And by the way, I didn't do any kind of this analysis because I didn't know it, and my doctor probably didn't know it. But to calculate my 30-year risk based on those values I had, this is just how you manipulate the probabilities, is I just calculate my chance of not having a heart attack given those probabilities, and I subtract the result from one, and that the leftover is my chance of having a heart attack. So my 30-year risk, standing at age 50 and looking ahead 30 years, it's the chance of me not having a heart attack over the next 10 years, which is 94.1%, because I had a 5.9% chance of having a heart attack, so I have a 94.1% chance of not having a heart attack, and so on. And I multiply those three numbers together, and I subtract it from one, and it comes out to about 0.34. In other words, about a 1 in 3 chance that I'm going to have a heart attack over the next 30 years. Now, even though when I look at the individual statistics there, I think that, yeah, they're kind of high. I think they've been overestimated. A 1 in 3 chance of having a heart attack in the next 30 years kind of has a realistic feel to it. So I'm happy to go with it for the sake of this argument. So let's calculate my absolute risk reduction under these circumstances. Well, my probability of a heart attack over 30 years is 0.34. So my absolute risk reduction is a 0.36 times the 0.34, or about 0.123, which is about 1 in 8. You know, 0.125 would be 1 in 8. So we're just going to call it 1 in 8. So if I draw my pie chart, well, there's a 5 out of 8 chance that I'm not going to have a heart attack. And there's a 1 out of 8 chance that I'm going to be saved from a heart attack. And a 2 out of 8 chance that I'm going to have the heart attack even though I take the treatment. So I look at this, and my value system says, well, I look at the yellow and the red, and I say, that's not doing me any benefit if I fall into any of those categories. And there's this little slice. It's not as small as that 1.1%. It could be substantial. But that's a chance that I'm going to be saved by this. And if everything else were equal, if this was absolutely a no-cost treatment, I might consider it, it's worth doing. At least I've improved my chances, because you may look at it and say, well, the yellow and the green are what are important to me, because that just says I have a 3/4 of chance of not having a heart attack. But the way I look at it with my value system is I say, well, there's a 7 in 8 chance that I'll take this drug for 30 years and get no benefit from it, okay? And again, if there were no cost to it, and I'm not even just talking financial costs, but I'm talking about the health cost of actually taking the treatment, because it does come with a health cost, those are subjects of future videos. But this is just gives us a context to look at. So what's the point of all this? Well, the point is the advertised relative risk reduction and absolute risk reductions are not likely to be meaningful for you. The reason that the RRR is probably not meaningful is because generally people don't understand it. I'm convinced that most doctors don't. If your doctor told you you had a 40% chance of having a heart attack over the next 10 years, you should be worried. I would be worried. And they said, but we can reduce it by 36% if you just take this drug. Well, what are you thinking? You're thinking, well, 40% minus 36%, I'm down to 4%. Well, that's an absolute risk reduction, but that's not the figure that the doctor just gave you. The doctor probably doesn't even realize it. The doctor probably thinks they really are going to reduce you from 40% down to 4%, but they're not. They're going to reduce you from 40% down to about 26%. Not inconsequential, but not as good as they're making it sound. So that's why the relative risk reduction, not that it's untrue, but that it gets misinterpreted. Now, the absolute risk reduction, that 1.1% value that gets trotted out by the people on that side of the argument, well, if your absolute risk reduction is really that low, that means your risk of a heart attack is around 3%, and hopefully, your doctor's not talking about giving you statins when you're that low of a risk, but they might, and I have seen that, and again, we will discuss that in future videos. So the casual calculations using the most generous assumptions show that the statins, they're far from wonder drugs. I think that's the key point, is that these things are shown to us. This is a wonder drug. I mean, this is going to help everybody. And you look at it, and here's the pie chart. I'll show it again. And it's really not all that great. I mean, if I want to see a risk reduction, I want to see the chart look like this pie chart on the other side, all green. I want to know that it's 100% effective. And if you think that's unreasonable in the field of medicine, it's really not. Maybe it is for heart attack risk, because that's such a complicated thing, but consider a rabies. I don't want to say the V word, because the YouTube algorithm will throw a disclaimer on my video. But think of a rabies treatment. Well, rabies is just about 100% fatal. It's like 99.99% fatal if you get rabies and you start showing symptoms. But the treatment for it is actually pretty close to 100% effective. So it is possible in the field of medicine to get an all green, pie chart of this type. So this analysis, it's just one factor in many, and it provides a context. I mean, there are contexts, like I said, if there was actually no cost and no harm from taking this treatment, that's a context in which you might say, yeah, I should take that treatment. But once we start talking about the harms of it, in this context, it's like, how much harm are you willing to accept? How much damage to yourself are you willing to accept? How much financial cost are you willing to accept? And this gives us a context. So that's the point of this, that we can't just look at this in isolation and use it for a decision, but it can inform our other decisions. So as usual, I'd like to ask you to please like and comment and share these videos. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Hit the notification bell so you know when I post something new. And if you haven't seen my introductory video where I give some important caveats, I recommend that you look at this one now. Thanks for listening.